Thank you. Thank you. So, good afternoon, everybody. Let me start with, well, it's quite a shocker. This is the widest audience I've ever seen, I reckon. My name is Rolf Bezemer. I work for a company called Lumes. We are a supplier of telemanagement solutions, everything that has to do with enabling HR professionals to make their HR policies and programs more effective within organizations. Before I go into our presentation, I want you to make three promises, two apologies, and one answer. That's my sort of starting point for today. The first promise is I will keep it light and short, which is in light of the timing today, not a bad thing. The second is, halfway this presentation, I will wake you up. And the third part of my promise is I'm going to ask you for a favor towards the end of my presentation. Because despite the title of my presentation today, I'm also looking for some answers from the audience in how you perceive technology within your function. And for some sort of reason, technology is very nice on paper, but it does not always have the effect that we anticipate it to have. So, three promises, two apologies. Number one, my English. I'm Dutch. I've been in Singapore since 2010. Unfortunately, for whatever reason, my English will not get better. That's, you know, despite whatever learning we're going to put into place, it's not going to work. Number two, the second apology has to do with me typecasting. In order to make the presentation a little bit light, I've created a few roles and trends and technology trends over the course of a few hundred years. And this is not too scientific, so bear with me, you know, there can be bits and pieces that might be a little bit different in your head. The answer that I'm going to give you is the following. 2 meters. So, no, 2 meters, it's only just now. Do you have one of these?
Yeah, it's on the...
Ah, this is the thing. Ooh. Working for a technology company. Yes, let's talk HCM. So what I would like to do over the course of the next 20-25 minutes is to talk about what we call the new era of human capital management systems. So it will be a technological point of view, because over the past 10 years, I've attended many of these events, and all of them have a similar outfit. It's around HR business partners or talent managers, changing roles of HR. It is around the changing dynamics of the war of talent and whether or not we will be able to retain people, hire people, develop people, and ultimately be better than our competition. And with that in mind, I will try to put those historical perspective on IT. So what has IT done in order to help HR people to come where we are? I would like to then try to change the mindset. Why are we doing this? Why? And I think that some of the speakers before me already have paved the path. Some of the HR programs that are in place are not always as effective as we would like them to be. So I will talk a little bit about that. And ultimately, I will bring it to the big finale, which has to do with how can we help you in order to make it more exciting with what we call the new era of HCM. So, HR is quite an interesting team. Already, the tribal members living in these type of cages around the globe realized that certain people have different skill sets, and that it makes sense that certain people go out hunting simply because they're better, they bring home food, and others were not so good at it. And already by sort of developing those skills, I reckon, you know, the first HR elements were being introduced. And even the Chinese emperors had the first assessments taking place and teams helping the emperor pick and choose servants that were fit for the job. Analyzing their skill set, making sure that they get trained, and making sure that these people stay around in order to help the emperor enjoy himself or his crew. And even in the Middle Ages, in the European context, the first apprentices were being introduced, where artisan guilds would recruit very young people to train them and help them to do all sorts of different jobs later on. And it proved to be an effective instrument. So from the first HR element, I would say, it was a finance thing. There was somebody in the finance department that was supposed to make sure that people get paid, which is quite relevant for a lot of employees, but it is also quite relevant for finance people. So there was not so much of a system. The role was very much focused around personnel, making sure that things happen, and systems were none or in Excel. With the introduction of mainframes, all of a sudden, a lot more possibilities came to the marketplace, because now there was a way to make sure that we actually knew who was working for our company. Because part of all these big mainframes that were supporting finance or supply chain or whatever it was, it allowed organizations to have IT teams, and those IT teams had smart people, and those smart people thought they would help HR by building slowly some pieces to capture employee data. So, I need to look there. Payroll and ERP solution were the first that actually took a bit of content in that. That slowly transformed from an HR role to what we call the introduction of human capital management, realizing that employees are a bit more than an individual. They represent an asset, human capital, and we should take care of those people. So the systems became more widely accepted. There were even better teams of IT people developing software for HR people to have the payrolls covered, to introduce timekeeping, maybe to do some claims, maybe do some other transactional HR. And even some of them, but they were very, very, very outgoing, they would introduce bits and pieces around performance management. Systems in those days were HRIS systems. They were awesome, very long to implement, very rigid. Once they were there, you couldn't change them, at least not without upsetting everybody else in your organization. HR was always last to receive it, and once it was there, there was very little user adoption with people. But that said, HR transformed from being an HR manager into more of a business partner, allowing to have more discussion with the business and to introduce targeted training programs. Luckily enough, the majority of the organizations today will recognize themselves in having some sort of a system of engagement. We know who we employ. We have done the transactional HR. It's pretty well covered. We pay people. But we also now have the ability to come up with very targeted programs. And some companies, like Aircel, spend a lot of effort on learning. But we also have a lot of organizations that are much more in the recruiting phase or in the performance phase or whatever it is. All this different priority. And as a result, because of ERP vendors being so lousy in delivering software for HR people, all sorts of companies like Lumes emerged that were very specialized on delivering technology in the cloud that helped organizations do recruiting, performance management, learning, compensation, and all sorts of building blocks, and then talk with these other systems. The role of HR changed as well, from a business partner, a little bit more sophisticated, up in the chain to talent manager. Realizing that human capital is nice, but talent is even more important, and how do we deal with this talent? So that's, I reckon, where a lot of you will recognize themselves. We feel, and the agenda of the two-day event and the discussions that we had this morning, there's a bit more to it. Because talent management is nice, but engagement is better. Having process in place is very nice, but having empowerment programs in place is even better. So ultimately, what I would like to say before going into the next part of the presentation is we are at some sort of flipping point in time in which HR practitioners, rather than talking around what kind of HR programs they would like to introduce, actually sort of start working on that and get rid of a lot of things they have and take a new sort of start in HR. And much of it has to do with what we call adopting a millennial mindset. And this has nothing to do with Gen Ys, because everybody here in this meeting room in some sort of shape is millennial. We have smartphones. We do all sorts of things on our smartphones. We like it. We look for the weather. We look for the stock prices. We look for our emails. We send pictures. We use all sorts of technology that makes us happy the whole day around. So one of the killer questions in adopting a millennial mindset is not so much compare us to a Gen Y, but is to realize how does it come that from a consumer perspective, the whole day around, you look at your iPhone, you're a happy person, but when you come to the office and you see business applications and HR applications, they suck. You don't want to use them, you don't want to click on them. If you click on them, you don't know what to do. And it is not always because we, technology providers, have invented that principle. Quite often it is because you tell us how you want to use our technology. So apparently there's something wrong. And at LUMES we have introduced a sort of a revamp of everything we've done. Because for the past 20 years, we have been building software to help HR people comply with long list of requirements when it comes to performance management or training and development or skills and competency without, you know, really realizing or advising our customers. So why? Why on earth would you do that? Which is nice if you are a consultant, but it is not a nice question to answer if you are a software vendor. So we have come up with something else and say, well, we need to make sure that we understand why certain applications are being utilized so much. And what can we take away from that and present back to the HR domain? So Facebook revamped the way we communicate. It started off as a nice student type of practical joke. Everybody that has seen the movie, you get very romantic about the concept. I wish it was there when I was at university. I would have loved it. But what they've done is quite spectacular. They take a very simple concept, communication, but they mastered it to whatever extent it is today. It allows you to not only share, communicate, socialize, share again, share another time, find stuff from people that you really don't have an interest in, but because it is gossip, it's on the wall anyway, you start reading it, clicking it. So apparently, by nature, people like the concept of knowing a bit more what's going on in their social environment than only looking to a one-dimensional piece of communication. So that's quite important, because Facebook works. We don't need to argue about that. And part of that we would like to include in the technology and how we develop software. The second thing is Apple. And they have great products. Again, no arguments about that. But what is quite interesting is that they have an app for everything. And that app works. And even more important, if you project it to the HR function, it works without training. Whatever you do, you click on it and you expect something to happen. If it doesn't happen, you don't use the app. It's very simple. You get rid of the app, you move on to the next one. So if you take that concept and then project back to HR and think, okay, so we need to make things available that are so stupid-proof, not because we are managing the exception and we are managing all sorts of things. We need to have things that people actually love to use. Because if they love to use things which you know in your day-to-day situation, you use it. So the third part had to do with YouTube. Because YouTube, almost equally as Facebook, started off as a portal where people would upload personal clippings, and it was very nice to see how your camping exercise in the weekend was. But it transformed. It transformed to something much bigger, where people not only share pictures and clippings and what's not, but there's videos from all sorts of artists over the globe that think it is important to have their things on YouTube. There's companies that started to recognize that in building an employer brand, it is important to show off on YouTube on what it is to work for your organization, on how you socialize people, on what kind of great activities you do beyond the workplace. There's more and more clippings on products, on services, on everything. So YouTube, even though it is a sort of a portal for personal home clippings, even transformed it to sort of a big tutorial online learning content. Because if you ask a 5-year-old kid on how to get to the next level in Minecraft or whatever game, sorry, I still use Minecraft because it's the only game I know, Bobby, they would go to YouTube. That's where learning happens. They type in Minecraft next level 23, And there will actually be clippings telling them how to go to the next level. And if it is around rainbow gloom, there will be an instruction how to make a bracelet with different colors, with a big knot, a small knot, and whatever it is. It's on YouTube. And equally so, there's many organizations, and most likely it started off in the retail industry, where all of a sudden, smart HR people realize that training is not only classroom or lengthy or curriculum, but it is sometimes very simple, impactful, and 2 minutes. And we worked with a large telecom provider that, as a result, instead of having all their retail staff in classroom explaining how great the Apple iPhone 6 is, they send them 2 minute clippings. So even turning downtime into uptime because there's nobody in the store, what did they do? They click on a fact sheet, what we call a fact sheet, but it is a clipping, 1 minute, explaining why the iPhone 6 is awesome compared to the Galaxy and compared to the whatever. And they can deploy on a global scale because they align it completely with the introduction of different phones in different parts of the world. So the whole environment of learning, sharing, collaborating has changed. All these companies, they took a very simple idea, communicate, show off, and build apps, but they executed it quite well. And the killer question would be, so what are the attributes that would redefine what we feel about human capital management systems? Human capital management and the systems that work together that. And I promise you, halfway, which we are, to wake you up. So be alert. There's a prize to win in the next 5 minutes. It's a $5,000 voucher to go into the casino next door, so you can skip the afternoon part. And you can play the tables. But if we talk about, so what can we take away from all this great consumer-related technology that is available on the market, that we love to use? There's no question in your mind by downloading, upgrading. You never will read the terms and conditions. You simply say, yes, give me the new version, because that's how it works. Because it's human-centered. It is designed for you. It is designed to do something you like, whether it's the news, whether it's a game, or whatever it is. You need to be there. So that thing is quite important, because as an HR function, the fundamental thing you need to do in order to increase those the productivity of your workforce, to drive that innovation and collaboration, is to make sure that people actually use the stuff that you develop for them. Otherwise, it's pointless. So HR software, unfortunately, has not been designed by HR people, but was mainly driven by IT people. Managers hate it. They do. There's hardly anybody in the world that has a big smile on their face the moment they log into a business application. I need to do my expenses in Oracle. They're not here, so I can say it's terrible. And I consider myself, you know, to be a technologist, but every time I log in, I don't have my password, the link doesn't work. For whatever reason, things go wrong. And this is only, you know, my expenses. And I have to be honest, because somebody else is doing it for me, because I need to run over and see whether it checks out. So human-centered design is super relevant when we think about how are we going to deliver the new era of technology to help HR people do a better job. Because managers need to love it, employees need to embrace it, and candidates equally so. They need to be able to think, wow, this is amazing. And I would dare you here in this meeting room to show hands who knows that if you now go to your company career site and you click on careers and you click on jobs, that you have a nice, crisp, mobile experience. It doesn't. But more than 35% of job traffic comes to search engines from mobile devices. So apparently your candidates, they're on the device. They're not on your desktop. They don't even have a desktop. They have a tablet. So sometimes we need to rethink what it is about. And the second item, it needs to be mobile first. It seems like an easy thing to say, but the majority of software vendors have mastered taking little bits and pieces and make it compatible with an iPad and then say, here you go, you can use it on a mobile device, but still, you know, it's you need to type in and you know how it works. It doesn't. So mobile first means that you take that consumer behavior and instead of type, you swipe. That's how it works. You click and select. You do things. That's how mobile first works. Mobile first is not re-engineering something that you have currently in your office and think, okay, let's have somebody make an app for it. That doesn't work. It needs to be native for mobile. So that's what we do. Time to wake up. I'm going to test your mobile intuition to see, well, if you're a smart audience. So I have two prizes to be won in order to get the two balls moving around on the screen. So one goes to the right, the yellow one, and the purple can either go to the left or it can go to the top. Ready? I will already introduce what you need to do. Is take out your phone. It's allowed. You take out your phone and you type in this thing. And the first two people that have the balls on the place where they can come over here. They don't need to answer questions, they just get a prize. Still nobody there? Ooh. Crying and didn't get it going. Thanks. We were in Malaysia, by the way, two days ago. Yeah. Number one. Somebody else put their phone in the air to show me that it is done. Two. Okay. Oh, sorry. You were already here.
Thanks.
Here you go. I need to check it, of course. Here you go. Yes. Very good, thanks. Too late, only two prizes. Oh. So I just want to check. Who started trying to double click and drag? Yeah, you should do that. So who started with clicking only? Sort of click and then see whether the ball moves. Well, who was smart enough to instantly start tilting it? Okay, so you won the prize. Excellent. You can already see that something that is mobile optimized is a bit more than an application that you use on a desktop. It is designed to make it happen. This game is obviously not very doesn't need to do a lot. The third element of that new paradigm that we're going to use in creating new technology has to do with collaboration. So we have human-centered, mobile-first, and now collaborative. We need to be able to, because apparently we like to gossip, we like to share, we are very interested to see what other people are doing. We appreciate LinkedIn because they show us stuff that is relevant to us. They do. They data mine everything we type in, all the friends you have. They do all sorts of suggestions the whole day, who you should meet, what you should read, where you should eat. And on the workplace, this will be very helpful. And I think the speakers earlier today already sort of tapped into that. How can you empower your workforce to be more productive? Well, one of the things is to make them share, is to make them understand what's going on, is to be informed about competitive intelligence, around successes that have been booked somewhere in the business, around stuff that goes wrong, but you found out a solution and you can give a tap on the shoulder of one of your colleagues. So the tools that we need, they need to be very, very much collaborative. And I think that with Chatter and Jammer and all sorts of technology, it is already there, but we not always utilize it in a way that HR can take ownership and make it theirs. Because if you look at Chatter nowadays, it's a sales tool. But if you are smart, you make it a human-centric or employee-related tool. Next to the collaboration, it needs to have something to do with user adoption. People need to be able to use it without training. If you define something in your organization, a process that you need to explain to people how to use, and performance management to me in a Singaporean context is one of those, it's often so extremely complex with so much content behind that people are not very likely to use it. If you do things well, it should boost your user adoption and it should be an experience to remember. And that, I think, is what we try to realize. And with that, we feel that we have entered a new sort of era of human capital management technology. because those technologies, they should be able to reduce complaints and complexities. They should be able to help your business managers in your organization on the go to communicate with their employees, to discuss about tasks and achievements, to provide feedback, to continue on different KPIs. And it needs to be swipe, not type, number one, and it needs to be pick and click instead of anything else. and if we are able to do that, I'm sure that your organization will at least say, well, we're not completely agreeable to the whole workflow of setting goals and performance management, what's not, but at least, you know, it's simple. It helps, it's ongoing, it's available, it's mobile, because 70% of managers are moving around from meeting to meeting, from business to business. They're on the go, so this tool needs to be very much centered around mobile and social. And obviously, it needs to be there anytime. And we feel with the proposition that we're going to make and relying on what Salesforce has to offer, that we have that ability to make it available anytime, anywhere. And every CIO around the globe will have some sort of reference to Salesforce. It works already for a long time. So it is not different from a contextual perspective. It still will be around hiring people, attracting people, onboarding them, making them efficient, reward them, succeed them, and pay them. But it is with a completely different different understanding of what it needs to do. So I will just give you a peek for 2.5 minutes before finalizing my presentation, which has to do with the recruiting part of it.
You may get the feeling that talent acquisition tools were created to serve processes rather than people. You'd be right. That all changes with Talent Objects Recruit, a talent acquisition suite for the Salesforce platform that puts people at the center of everything and can turn every employee into a high-powered recruiter. We interviewed countless HR professionals and hiring managers and reimagined a talent acquisition platform from their perspective. Then we built it. Engagingly simple, with intuitive workflows and swipe instead of type or pick and click interfaces wherever possible. Mobile from top to bottom, for productivity for HR professionals or hiring managers on the go, or a job candidate at home, in the gym, or out to dinner. Collaborative at every step of the hiring process, for HR professionals, hiring managers, and candidates. We've integrated Salesforce Chatter, so you'll never leave your best candidates hanging. Social, so that every employee can be a brand ambassador and recruit marketer, helping bring top talent into the fold. Self-service, extending an already familiar environment with talent acquisition capabilities, virtually assuring immediate productivity for Salesforce users. CRM at the core, so that every interaction is associated with a person and nothing is left to chance on the journey from candidate to employee and beyond. Talent Objects Recruit turns the cloud platform your CIO already trusts into a robust recruitment engine. And because all Talent Objects modules are native to the platform, they tap into reporting capabilities that Salesforce users have loved since day one. This is the tool that businesses have been waiting for, one that extends the Salesforce platform with an engaging, brand-bolstering, one-on-one experience for candidates and simplifies requisition and hiring processes for managers. Beyond that, one that recognizes that in the race for talent, collaboration is the foundation rather than a nice-to-have. When it comes to people, you never get a second chance to make a first impression, so why risk it? With Talent Objects Recruit, people are the center of everything.
So apologies for the commercial, but it gives you at least an impression of what we are trying to achieve, which ultimately is around delivering technology that people like to use, that empowers employees to be more effective, better performing, smarter in what they do, and equally so for managers. And I think this morning somebody already talked about being the conductor in front of the orchestra. That's in the end what HR is about. It is making sure that people have the ability to exceed in whatever they are supposed to do. And we feel that we make it simple, mobile, and social, and that with that in mind, that we have that capabilities. I still owe you one promise, which is to ask something from you, because for 2 days, there will be a lot going on about how we need to change the HR practice within within the geography that we're working in, and how we need to impose new strategies and tactics in order to engage with our workforce. But unfortunately, when we meet you on Monday talking about technology, you will give me a list of 100 pages with functionalities you want to see based on what you do today. So the question I would like to ask, and this applies for my colleague software vendors as well, is the next time around that you meet up in order to discuss technology within your organization, on the one hand, you show them the requirements, but you also allow them for 15 minutes to tell you how they think that it will work for you when you really apply the best practices that are available in the market. So thank you very much. I think it's time anyway for a break.
Yes,
correct?
Any questions for John?
Tea time.